call the meeting to order, and we're going to go outside of the typical schedule here until our other members show up. But the first item would be the approval of the agenda, and we do have one agenda addition, and that's a request for approval for the union contracts for corrections and highway for 2017 through 2019.
Move to approve with the addition.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? If not, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried. I'm going to hold off on the employee recognition until our other board members are here and our administrator. Do we have any citizens to be heard today on items that are not on the agenda? Any citizens to be heard? Seeing none, we'll move on. Approval of the bills and vouchers.
They're still here, so.
You can still approve them.
I'll move to approve.
We have a motion to approve.
I'll second.
And we have a second. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same sign. Motion carries. Approval of minutes.
Move to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried. Dave, I wonder if we can just quickly take your overweight permit down. Can we do that one right now while we're waiting on Mr. Berg?
So what we typically do here is when we get a request for an annual overweight permit, they're approved initially by the county board, and then if the recipient or the applicant wishes, then they can be approved in future years by the county engineer. We were approached by a business owner, farmer, south of Holly. He needs about 1 mile of County Road 12. There's another gentleman that has the same permit on this roadway. What they need is when the restrictions come on, they need to get their commodity out of their business location out to a 10-ton highway, which is what the permit is set aside for. It's set aside for ag products, commercial ag products, as well as perishable items and those sort of things. So I guess I felt this does follow our permit guidelines, and we've approved a permit almost similar for his neighbor across the street that does trucking as well.
I'll make a motion to approve the request.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried. You guys might as well just stay up here. We'll deal with yours as soon as. I'm going to just go ahead with those employee recognition.
Did you come
up with this?
Yeah,
that's is this working? Good, all right. So we have,
three recognitions this morning for length of service. And the first one we have is for Darren Redman from the law enforcement. Say about all of these people that I was writing some thank you notes to some of the people that were in between their 15 and 20 year anniversaries, and one of the things that I think we can say to all of you people is that your length of service and your knowledge that you've gained really becomes an asset to our company, and we just want to really thank you for your service.
Thank you.
All right. Jim Schreiner, 25 years for this bubbly one.
Yes.
So a grateful recognition for your service.
All right. Thank you.
Brian, did you want to make any comments about Kim? And then I'll maybe.
Kim?
I
know,
huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. Why don't you?
We were talking earlier about. So I came in, interned in the office in about 1995, and Kim started in 1992. Right. So we used to be down in the hallway on the second floor where before it was remodeled, there used to be long hallways here, and we had offices on each side of the hallway at one point, but when Kim started, it was just a small, cramped-in little area that we had cubicles in the front, and I had a little spot to intern in the back part, and we had a pretty fun office. There was only four attorneys at the time, and me as an intern, and so if you imagine kind of the TV show The Office, it was kind of like that. So, but we had a great time. So I've known Kim for 20 plus years of your time working here, and just loved every minute of it. Appreciate everything you've done for the office and for the county, just like you said. So thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you. So I see I think the sheriff is basking in the sun someplace this week, which is much deserved, but. Mark, did you want to make any comments on your fellow officer here?
Thank you. I started with the sheriff's office here about 2002. Darren was working here before I was. In that time, Darren and I have been not only patrol deputies together, but also patrol sergeants. And Darren has served in several roles at the sheriff's office, from day patrol to night patrol to a night patrol sergeant. He's been a PTO. He's currently in charge of our TZD program, which is something I'm very fortunate of because I know nothing about that program. So I'm happy Darren is able to take that over, and Darren has a lot of years and knowledge up in that head of his, and we appreciate having him here with the sheriff's office. And Darren, thank you very much for all you do for the sheriff's office and for the citizens of Clay County.
And our next one also is a 25 years, and that's Rebecca Peterson. And Rebecca is a financial worker with Social Services.
I'd like to thank Becky for 25 years as citizens of Clay County. When she first started, she was one of our family workers that worked with all family programs and became an expert in healthcare and a great asset to our agency and office for people that had healthcare questions. Then a few years ago, there was a program called MedShare that was started. I don't know if any of you heard about it. Becky then, with her knowledge with healthcare, became an integral part of that program, and since then has volunteered to be Clay County's representative down at DHS. They meet monthly. Becky gets down there about every other month, to help out and talk about some policies and changes and trying to get the system, some of the kinks worked out still. So she's doing a great job and is a great asset to our unit.
Okay, Dave, it's we're a little bit past our bid opening time, but at this point in time, we will do the bid opening for the courthouse parking lot project.
Yeah, this is the bid opening for the three parking lots. We got the brand new one in the northwest part of the campus that we recently did the home demos on. It's also for some expansion right directly in front of the courthouse, out towards 11th Street, as well as the mill and overlay in front of the Family Service Center. We checked online at 9 o'clock, and there was no electronic bids, so we don't have any online bidding to take a look at today. We've got three paper bids here. We will tear them open, look for bid bonds, and then one thing to note too, there is an alternative one and alternate two. Alternate one combined with the base bid would be for asphalt paving, and then alternate two combined with base bid would be for concrete paving. So we will open these up and we will analyze them and then bring them back in 1 week with a recommendation.
All right, very good.
First bids from construction engineers from Grand Forks, North Dakota. We've got a bid bond present, you want 5%?
They do have numbers here for both alternates. So the combined base bid plus alternate one for construction engineers, $968,094.20. $968,094.20. And base bid plus alternate two, $1,151,758.60. $1,151,758.60.
All right, next bid's from Key Contracting, West Fargo. Bid bonds present, amount 5%.
Key Contracting also has both alternates bid here. Alternate one, $713,206.89. $713,206.89. Base bid plus alternate two. And it looks, I think that's 908.
Yep.
$908,982.09. $908,982.09.
Next bid's from Northern Improvement from Fargo, North Dakota.
Okay, they've only bid grand total base bid plus alternate one, and their bid is $812,776.40. $812,776.40, and no bid for alternate two.
All right. And the last bid's from Op Construction from Fargo. Present, amount of 5%.
Probably got the grant over there. All right. So OP typically doesn't do asphalt paving, so they did not put a bid in for alternate one. Alternate two, base bid plus alternate two of $1,062,297.70. $1,062,297.70.
So Dave, you guys will go through those tabulations and come back next week?
Yeah, yep. I mean, lots to look at. I think we had some really good bids here.
Yep.
A lot of real similarities. Biggest thing we'll have to decide, like kind of like we did when we did the alternate bid for the last parking lot.
Mm-hmm.
How much more are we willing to pay for the white versus the black, but really good bids here. This might be a tough decision.
Okay.
We'll more than likely work with our highway committee a little bit, either hold a special meeting or maybe we can just via email a little bit on that.
We're meeting this afternoon.
Okay.
Highway tracking.
Oh, great.
Aren't we?
Yep. Yep. Okay. We should be able to check the numbers by then. So.
Sounds good. We'll bring a recommendation or we'll sure. have a discussion at that point.
Sounds good. Thank you. Next, we have a presentation from West Central Minnesota Community Action, Inc. Ms. Missy.
Hi.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Thanks for allowing me to come and visit with you. Typically in the past, I've come every year and talked about the programs that we do in Clay County and kind of give you a little report. And so our agency does the Energy Assistance Program and the Weatherization Program, which are federally funded from the Department of Energy.
Can I ask, Mr., you make sure you're talking in that mic?
Yeah.
There you go. Okay.
Is that okay?
Mm-hmm.
And so Clay County, this past heating season, we served 1,938 households. And we spent $1,200,498 in energy assistance to, and that's direct payments to vendors for fuel. We did another $152,000 in weatherization assistance, and those programs help make homes more energy efficient with insulation, furnace repair, and ductwork, things like that. So we work with Lakes and Prairies Community Action, which is the community action agency that governs Clay County, in a variety of projects. We'll be starting a group cares camp project now. We have a meeting tomorrow in Breckenridge. We'll be operating that program together with Lakes and Prairies for Wilkin County. So that's exciting. So any questions about our energy assistance program and weatherization activities that we do here in Clay County?
Where do your funds all come from? Is that in the report here? Where do your funds
come from? It actually is. If you look back, maybe it's on one of the first pages. Yeah, the first page in there is a pie chart of whether it's federal, state. So 51% of our funding, 55% of our funding is federal. Another big program for us is the Head Start program, which Lakes and Prairies does for Clay County.
Okay.
So energy assistance and weatherization both are federal programs through the Department of Energy.
Now you said you get funded from Head Start, or is Head Start one of your expenditures?
We get funding for Head Start. And that's largely federal. We get a little bit of state money, but largely it's a federal program as well that comes through DHS.
Missy, do you want to talk a little bit about that group cares camp?
Absolutely.
What you guys accomplished?
Yeah, we every other year we do a group cares camp project where 400 children and their adult leaders come into the area, and we do projects like wheelchair ramps, we paint homes, do minor caulking, sealing, those kinds of things. But last year the last time West Central operated it, we did it in Herman, Minnesota, which, if you know, Herman's a very small community, and we built a dozen wheelchair ramps, and it's, you know, one of the stories was a little girl who had never had, she was about 12, she had never had her wheelchair in the house, and it was the opportunity for her to get in the house with her wheelchair, and, you know, it's a really moving program, it's Christian-based, it's faith leaders come with their teenage youth groups typically, and it's a mission trip, and it's a really feel-good week. And so that's happening summer of 2018 in Breckenridge. So we'll be raising funds for that. We have to raise about $18,500, and they bring with them $18,500, and that is the money used for materials.
Wasn't that something that we used to have going on in Clay County annually here? I know that John Young was really involved with that.
Well, this is the partnership, and it rotates.
Yeah.
Okay.
We kind of switch. So this year we're bringing it back to Lakes and Prairies territory, but Breckenridge, and we can work 30 miles around Breckenridge.
Okay.
Yeah. I think we've done several in Barnesville,
yes.
Right?
Barnesville and Holly.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. John Young was very. Yeah. And Joe Peterson worked.
Yep, Joe Peterson, yeah. Okay.
So do you just pick one community out? Like you said, you go to Herman and you did 12 of them.
Well, no, we did 60 homes, but we did 12 wheelchair ramps.
Oh,
but
okay.
60 projects. So it kind of depends on how many youth we get. That's how many, determined how many projects we get. And so tomorrow, the leader from the Group Cares Camp comes, and literally what he does is he goes to the school and counts shower heads, and that tells them how many students can come to a school. Personally, I was really worried about Herman because it's a very small school, but it worked just beautifully. And we've been doing these, I think, for 10 years, 10 or 12 years, that we've had Group Cares Camp, and a lot of the youth return to Minnesota to do these because they like it here so much, and we, you know, we plan some fun things for them on Wednesday afternoon. They have an afternoon of fellowship, and, you know, so we get a lot of the adults and their youth groups that want to come back, and they come back year after year.
So you go out to communities and ask them, do you have some projects? I mean, now Breckenridge, did you go to them, or did they come to you and say, we've got a whole bunch of projects? Or?
We went to Breckenridge. Lakes and Prairies staff met with Breckenridge School District first. We hadn't done one in Wilkin County yet. That was kind of why we targeted Wilkin County. But once Bob Turley is the name of the gentleman that's coming tomorrow, once he determines how big the camp can be, then we'll start advertising and getting applications. And we've never had a problem obtaining applications. You know, depending on how big the camp is, we can do usually between 30 and 55 to 60 homes. And a lot of them are exterior painting, which makes a big difference in a small community when you go through town and see a bunch of homes that are painted. And so it's a fun project, and it's makes a big impact. So.
Right. Yeah, Mr. Chair, just to follow up on your question, you do continually put $2,500 a year in your budget, because it was an every other year project in the county, and it was $5,000, so then we just evened out the contribution every year. So you are putting $2,500 in, so when there's a Clay County project, you have some funds to support that.
Okay. That
so you're still doing that, yes.
Some funds in there.
Much appreciated.
But I didn't recall hearing about one last year either.
No.
In Clay County, so it's
pretty. No, there wasn't one that I was aware of last year.
I think there was a year off because of lack of
planning.
But also involvement on, we couldn't get people that wanted to come in.
So yeah.
Not that they didn't want to, but we just had a lack of.
Well, it was, I think it was, would have been 3 years ago when it was planned in Clay County, and a lot of the folks come from out east, and they had a really bad winter, and their school year was extended.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the camp was scheduled like the second week in June, and the kids just had to drop out because school wasn't finalized.
Okay.
So what we've learned from that is don't plan them until after July, you know, because that happens. And in, you know, Minnesota, we get out of school a lot earlier than they do out east. They have longer breaks, and they go until the 10th, 12th of June. So.
No, I know it's a good project when it's
It's a great project.
A lot of things get done. So.
Yeah. So we'll be hitting up the Wilkin County Commissioners this year for a donation. Any questions about? Yeah, no, that's it. I just wanted to do a report. You know, Clay County, I look at the numbers here. Clay County for us is almost as big as all of our other counties combined for energy assistance. 1.2 million in Clay County. Douglas County has 860,000. And then, of course, our other counties are much smaller. But Clay County is a big part of our budget. And so I feel like it's important to come and share with you what we do for your constituents, your residents.
Those individuals who qualify, how do they learn of this program?
Well, energy assistance is a national program. There's a lot of push, publications that come out for energy assistance. If you apply the year before, you're automatically on the list to receive an application. And so we have an office at the Clay County Service Center right across the road here. And that office is staffed 9 months a year approximately. We do lay off in the summer months because our money typically runs out in April for energy assistance. And so they can request an application. A lot of times the fuel vendors, if someone is in a status where they can't pay, the fuel vendors will actually say, have you talked to energy assistance? And here's the number. And so, you know, we have a cooperation with all of the vendors, not all, but most vendors, because the payment doesn't go to the client. The payment goes right to the vendor. Mm-hmm. And so it's very advantageous to have a vendor relationship with West Central. Mm-hmm. And of course, Moorhead Public Service is huge for us here in Clay County. We do a lot of work with them. And all of our furnace repairs, we do all local vendors. So we work with all the vendors here in Moorhead and Clay County. Mm-hmm. Thanks for having me.
Thank you. Kathy, good morning. You're going to bring Austin up with you, huh?
Good morning, Mr. Chair and Commissioners.
Good morning. We're going to talk about the Green Corps.
Yes, this is Austin Kropp. He's our current Green Corps member. And in the past, you've approved Public Health to host the AmeriCorps. Member from Green Corps, and we have a grant proposal again due in September. So Austin is here really to just provide a little bit of information, a few minutes, and if there's no questions after that, we can go from here.
Can get it pulled up.
Is there a...
I did flip it on, so I
looks like it's way down the
top. Okay.
It's trying.
Oh.
All right. Well, just wanted to share a couple minutes worth of material. I know Ken spoke last year as well. This is my second year in the Green Corps program with Partnership for Health over at Clay County Public Health. So I just want to share a few things about. Just a reminder what the Green Corps program is, a couple things I've been working on over the past couple of years. And this is my current service year that I'm in, which is my second, is actually the third year that Partnership for Health has had a Green Corps service member. So there was one before me, and now this is my second year. And my term wraps up around August 15th, and then so this new position would be a replacement for me starting around mid-September 2017.
If we decide to.
That's true. You can let me go. All right, so Minnesota Green Corps, it's an AmeriCorps program, so of course federally funded by the Corporation for National Community Service. The Minnesota Pollution Control Agency receives that money to basically administer this program. They put out a solicitation across Minnesota and usually get between 80 and 90 host sites applying to get a member to serve with them. They choose 40, so it's a pretty competitive program for host sites, so it's pretty impressive that Clay County has not only had a member with public health for a few years, but also on an office had members in solid waste as well.
Right.
So pretty good history with the program there. So again, about 40 members serving across the state of Minnesota, 1,700 hours, which is basically full-time over the course of about 11 months. And here's our cohort from last year. So Green Corps specifically, the projects are all environmental focused. So whether it's energy conservation, green transportation, which is what I do, things like stormwater, urban forestry, you know, waste prevention and recycling, and then living green outreach, which is kind of a combination of all of them, and that kind of fits the bill a little bit better for certain organizations. And so what I do specifically, I know I talked about this last year as well, but what I do specifically is working with Partnership for Health on biking and walking projects, which of course falls under green transportation and is a perfect crossover with some of the work that's already going on in public health, which with encouraging biking and walking. So last year, you may recall, I was involved in a Shovel Dilworth campaign, and that actually started a year before I was here. So this year, the campaign happened again. And actually worked with City of Dilworth staff to get them to run that program internally. So that's what they did this winter. It's hasn't been a ton of snow, but enough for them to do to run the program when it was snow, I guess. They've had a good response again this year, but I've helped them run that program now internally, and so hopefully that will continue in the years to come now that the city is taking it on. And that's actually evolved that partnership a little bit, because another thing I started this fall and will be completing this spring for them is, you know, of course, thinking about walkability in the winter especially, but all year round. Sidewalks are obviously very important. And the City of Dilworth did not have an existing map of what sidewalks are out there, what condition they're in. So one of the things I helped with that was kind of a maybe like the next step, I would say, as part of that Shovel Dilworth program to focus on sidewalks, was working with the city to do a sidewalk and actually shared use path network condition inventory for them as well this fall. Did the data collection this fall, put it into the GIS map you see here, and then I actually started taking some photos of some different areas too, to put together a little document for them. Started that this fall before the snow fell, got a little bit delayed by the snow, but I'll pick that up again in the spring and complete that for them. So this way they have a good picture of what their sidewalk network looks like, not only where there are issues and gaps within the current network, but where they might want to expand it. And all that is eventually feeding into future improvements that they can do to improve walkability, ADA accessibility for residents of Dilworth. Another great thing that I worked on is actually towards the end of my previous term over the summer. I was working with Concordia College on the Bicycle Friendly University program. So Port of Morehead as a community is a bronze level bicycle friendly community. That's a program run by the League of American Bicyclists. They also have a program for businesses and workplaces, and then a separate one for universities as well. So as kind of a way to continue to measure progress in the community and with specific institutions, we often seek out partners to work with us on this program, because whether or not they receive this award, it's a good inventory process to look at what are you doing, what are some easy next steps, what are some long-term goals that we can help set. And as a result of that process over the summer, working with Concordia College, I helped them work on this application and have helped them with various events to a community bike ride that they did. I worked on that with a group of health communication students at Concordia College. And that's happening, again, with a different group of students this spring coming up in April. But they actually received the award at the bronze level. We got a little bit of press for that, which is exciting. And so this year's bike ride, a community event in April that we're doing, is also going to be kind of a celebration of their award also, and talking about continuing things we can do to improve bikeability in the community. Streets Alive, again, last year I worked with Great Rides and with some other Partnership for Health staff to put together an application for some additional funding from Blue Cross Blue Shield of Minnesota. We got that, we were able to use that funding and some existing partnerships to kind of reinvigorate this plaza. If you've ever been down by US Bank in Moorhead, Streets Alive route goes right past there. Kind of, we were able to make that a vibrant space again. We had a pop-up bike lane there that we were able to put this funding towards. So it really enhanced the Moorhead side of the Streets Alive route last year, which was a great experience for people to see some kind of demonstration projects. And planning is already starting for Streets Alive, and I'm involved in that again this year. And the events this year are going to be June, two large events this year, June 25th and August. It's the last Sunday in August, I can't remember, but in past years, sometimes it's two, sometimes it's three. This year, it's two large events in June and August, and then there's going to be some smaller, rather than a third large event, there's going to be some smaller events kind of tacked on to existing community events. I know River Arts is one. Some other community events like that, they're going to use to promote the event as well. So that's another thing I'm involved in. One thing that we started this year and was a good opportunity to build on partnerships from the first year is something called Bike FM. This was a project we worked on with the Bicycle Alliance of Minnesota. Basically, the goal is to put together kind of an informal network of people involved in bike education in the area. One thing that's often identified in bike and pedestrian plans, for example, from FM MetroCog, is the lack of education opportunities. You know, there are some good things happening. They put out their bike maps. There's some education material on there as well. But there's a real lack of safety classes, of just, you know, getting common information out to the community about where can you bike, where can't you bike, what are the laws associated with biking. So this is a group of planners, bike advocates, public health, reps from the university, law enforcement, some current and former elected officials who have convened and are now meeting on a monthly basis to work on creating some more opportunities for bike education, whether it's a public campaign, whether it's a partnership that we just started through Community Ed to offer some bike classes. They're going to be in the spring, more community education catalog, but just really trying to address that issue where there's kind of been a lack of work in the past. And then, of course, coming up this spring, we have, we're not sure about Moorhead yet, but certainly some of the other areas that Partnership for Health serves are going to have bike rodeos again this year. The picture, bottom left picture, is actually from a bike rodeo we did during Streets Alive in Moorhead last year in June, or sorry, July it was. And then some other pictures there from Detroit Lakes and Perm. But we also work with these communities because we know that bike education, it's most important to do that when kids are young. And a lot of people grew up riding bikes, and we think that it's just something that everyone learns how to do when you're a kid. But you know, you go to some of these communities and you find out that that's just not the case. And so it's important to get the kids started with those good, safe habits when they're young, and hopefully make that a lifelong tool for transportation and recreation and health. And that's all I got for you. So any questions about the program or about the...
Do you do anything with bike share, like Fargo has the bike share thing? Yeah. I mean, you were talking about Concordia bike program there.
Mm-hmm.
Is that involved at all with bike share at all?
Yeah, I can share a little bit about that. So it's on hold a little bit with our involvement this year, but during my first year of service, we did work with Great Rides. We had a committee together, and we actually produced a planning document for how we might want to go about bringing Great Rides, which is a bike share, into Moorhead. And now it's more or less just an issue of funding. You know, it's kind of on the table with Great Rides about which partners that want to engage in Moorhead for funding, because those stations aren't cheap. I mean, they're in the neighborhood of $40,000 to $50,000 a piece. But they have a huge impact. So that's definitely coming down the road. We haven't been as involved with that this year, but like I said, I was involved with that that planning effort last year. One of the things that was really key to their success with, you know, their first season, they had 143,000 rides or something, and this past year they broke 100,000 again, was their partnership with North Dakota State University. So one of the big things they're working on, you referenced Concordia, is building those relationships with Concordia and MSUN, because there's a real natural built-in user base with the students there for those bikes. So I haven't been as involved with that this year because, like I said, it is on hold kind of funding reasons, but that is coming.
As far as for funding, with those funds from, I know on the Harkin Trails, they got funds and stuff like that. I don't know if those funds would be available or not for the bike program, unless it has to be a trail. I don't know.
I'm not sure. Mr. Chair, I don't think that deals with cost of the bike training. Mr. Chair, I have a question.
Yes.
And it is in regards to funding. And I'm not suggesting that we spend money on bikes, so don't get me wrong. But when you said you go out to some of these communities, or even in our own community right here, where you put on the bikes and you find that there's kids that don't know how to ride a bike because they don't have a bike, have you reached out to partners, Shields and other things, about maybe either repairing used bikes for the children that do not because that's got to be kind of heartbreaking when they come and they don't even know how to ride a bike and they're 8, 9 years old because they don't have a bike or they can't afford a bike. Is there, have we engaged in that type? Okay.
Yeah.
I see yes, so that's good.
Yeah, I can share a little bit about that. So two places where I've been most involved with that this year and last year are Detroit Lakes and Ferrum. And in both of those communities, you know, those events have been going on for 6 or 7 years, I mean, with Partnership for Health long before I was here. And so what they do, a couple things, is those, so bike rodeos are what we call those events, basically just the bike safety events for kids. So one thing that we do is we always have, sometimes it's employees from local bike shops that volunteer their time. Sometimes it's local bike clubs. I know Ferrum has one of those. They'll come with tools, they'll repair the bikes for kids, we have pumps, and actually the very first step of that process after they register when they get to the event is an inspection for their bikes. We make sure they're safe. Whatever bike they bring, we get it in the best working order we can, and then they can run a safety course. And then the other piece is each one of these the committees that put these events together that we help with, they also seek funding from the community. So for example, in Detroit Lakes, every year they get enough funding that they buy, I think, 6 or 7 really nice bikes for the kids from a local bike shop there. And they get donations from, you know, local banks, sometimes it's individual donors, but those committees have fundraising efforts in those communities. And Ferrum does a similar thing. I think they actually give away like 14 bikes, is what we gave away last year. So there's a good opportunity for, you know, a lot of bikes for kids to come into those communities every year. And often, you know, like I said, this is only my second year being involved with them, but those people that have been on these committees for 6, 7 years doing these events, they say you really see different kids every year.
That's right.
You know, it's not the same thing getting the bikes, but really it is every year new kids coming. And there are returners, of course, and that's good. We want to build on those schools, but they do see a new crew every year, which is great.
That's good to hear. Thank you.
Commissioner Mulder.
One thing that's been a really big thing at the Clay County Fair for decades is that community service groups, the Lions groups, donate a lot of bikes, and that's another thing that you could kind of piggyback off of, because I want to say they give at least 20 out during the fair each year.
Something else too that I remember years ago when I would go to the annual auction that's put on by the city, they obviously the big feature there are going in and they're auctioning off vehicles, but I know there used to be where they're over the year they'd collect an awful lot of bicycles that would never be reclaimed. That may be something to check into to see if, you know, I think maybe if from a community standpoint rather than getting a couple dollars for a bike or whatever, maybe something like that the city would be open to participating in a get a bike to a kid program.
Sure.
So,
yeah.
So I would, maybe that's something worth researching. Okay, anything else?
Okay, so Mr. Chair, we're just requesting to approve to submit for the grant, Minnesota Green Corps grant for the third year, and then also you should have a resolution, they require a resolution for the board to sign. Again, we just provide the office space and everything else is covered.
So that would be resolution 2017-12.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to make a motion to adopt that resolution.
Okay. Second. We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Not all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same.
Thank you very much.
Thank
you.
She, I would imagine, hasn't got the official one that you have to send in.
Yes.
Yeah. All right. All right. Thank you.
Thanks again.
All right, Rhonda. Rhonda and Pat. Good morning. Your first item is a need to replace a social worker position.
Yes. I've been so excited. We haven't had it come for a while. And resignation, but this is a good resignation. She's retiring. This is Kathy Hornish. She's been with us for almost 37 years. She's been working in our adult protection division, so we definitely are going to feel her absence, but we're excited for her as well. So I brought Pat with me. Pat is the supervisor of adult services, and she can talk a little bit about that particular program area. But we have just generally, we've seen an increase in those adult protection reports, as you might expect, as our population ages. We're continuing to see adult protection reports, and that's primarily what Kathy's role has been. We're seeking approval to replace her position, and we anticipate we might have some internal interest, so if you would support filling any backfilling with internal movement that might happen. We will not really see a budget savings this year, just with Kathy's longevity and being able to bring in on a new person, but our savings we will certainly see next year as we bring in somebody that's on the lower end of our scale. Mm-hmm. Okay. Any questions for us about the position?
Any questions?
I'll move to approve.
Okay, a motion to approve.
Second.
Second. Second. Yeah, we'll come back. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same sign? Motion carries. All right, and then we have a proclamation for National Social Work Month.
We do. March is National Social Work Month, and we have, as you know, we employ social workers at our agency. We have about 55 county agency social workers that are part of our 110 employees. As you've heard me talk over the years, they do a variety of things. As we just talked about, Kathy Burnes does our health protection. We work with families and children in our child protection, child welfare system. We work with adult mental health, developmental disabilities, our elderly, all kinds of stuff. Lots of issues we heard about this morning, a lot of families that are struggling with a variety of issues. So we want to take this time to honor them and the work that they do, and with a proclamation and some other events that we have planned for them this month of March. So we're hoping to support a proclamation of honor of their work.
Okay. You have the proclamation in front of you.
I'll move to approve the proclamation.
Second. And a second. Would you like me to read the proclamation? Okay, March is National Social Work Month, Clay County Proclamation. Whereas the primary mission of the social work profession is to enhance well-being and help meet the basic needs of all people, especially those most vulnerable in our society. Whereas social workers serve, advocate for, and empower millions of Americans each day and push to ensure equal rights for all. Whereas social workers are employed in all areas of our society to improve happiness, health, and prosperity, including in government, schools, universities, private agencies, communities, the military, and mental health and health care facilities. Whereas employers hire professional social workers because they provide compassionate services that help individuals, families, and children cope with problems and become positive contributing members to the community. Now therefore, in recognition of the numerous contributions made by our social workers for all they do to increase the well-being of individuals in our community, we, the commissioners of Clay County, proclaim the month of March 2017 as Professional Social Work Month. And we call upon all members of the community to join in celebration and support of social workers and the social work profession. Any further discussion on the motion and the proclamation? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Same sign. I didn't think there would be. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Okay, we have our agenda addition. Darren, you want to come up on this one? Good morning, Darren.
Good morning. Thanks for having me on at the meeting today. I got some late information last week, and I just want to bring it to the board. As part of our closed session we had last week on the contracts, just want to bring you up to date that on yesterday I got a signed copy of the correctional officer's contract.
They've agreed to the outline that we've put forward as well. The three and a quarter, two and a half, and two for 2019. And then some language that we had in there about double time on Christmas for any time hours worked over their regularly scheduled shifts. So that was the big sticking point that we had. And we have now have language in the contract that reflects what the board was talking about last week. The other thing is the highway contract. We had a teleconference with them on Thursday to tie up some loose ends. And they voted on that last night, Monday? Yeah, last night. And I got word that the vote did pass. They also, and I, as you can see from your insert here, your sheet, it kind of lays down what that contract has within it. It's a 3-year contract. We did get some language in there for a reopener for benefits in 2019. They are they dropped the $100 clothing allowance because we've got some workarounds for disposable clothing for that. They did agree to a $200 boot allowance every 2 years. If you recall, they wanted $175 every year for the boot allowance. And so last week, we kind of bargained that down to increasing that by $25 every other year. So it's a total cost of about $300 for that. Employees contribution in the 49ers pension fund, that would be no cost to the county. And they also deferred to the insurance committee for any insurance changes to the benefits, which the correctional officers have also done, which helps us as well. And then, of course, you see the 3.25%, 2.5%, or 2% for the 17, 18, and 19 contracts. So I do have the corrections contract in hard copy here for signature today, but I'll probably get the highway contract sometime this week, and I'll bring that to the board for signature if it's all agreed upon next week.
Question in regards to the insurance committee. I know we have different people from all the departments on there. I'm not sure that we have representatives from every union entity, do we?
Yes, we do. Whether they attend every meeting.
Okay, so everyone.
But everyone has a representative.
Okay, all right. That's
on that boot allowance, is that for everybody? I mean, how many, who's all corrected? Who's all covered by the corrections?
We're talking about, not the corrections.
Oh, highways.
We're talking, I believe, about 14 people.
So it's not every position.
No, it's mostly the truck drivers, maintenance workers, motor graders, maintenance shop, the people that are going to need steel-toed boots.
Okay, so some of the people in the contract will get a $200 or $300 allowance and some won't?
No. It's $25 boot.
Well, they increase it $25, though.
Yeah. The total cost of the county is approximately
$300. Oh, $300. Okay.
Yeah.
It's going to go up to $200. Okay.
Yes.
So not everybody gets it, though.
Those that aren't in the union would not get it. And everybody in the union is in a more or less safety position that wears steel-toed boots right now. So your maintenance workers, your truck drivers, your motor graders, your sign maintenance shop, those guys.
So if I'm not in the union, I don't get a boot allowance?
Nope.
Am I required to wear the boot?
I'm not sure I can answer that question. I mean, the people that aren't in the union.
I mean, part of our safety program.
I think clearly say that if the safety boot is required for your job, whether they're in the union or not, they're going to be provided.
Okay, that's all.
Yeah. But most of the people that aren't in the union are like your office workers, your.
Right, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
So we have request to approve both of these contracts for 2017 through 2019. And are they both, they're both retroactive then?
Yes, January 1st would be retroactive.
What's the board's wishes?
Make a motion to approve.
Do we need these separately or for each? Do we need a separate motion for each?
I would say since the motion includes both of them, you're okay.
Okay. Right.
You're including both, which it sounded like you did.
Okay, all right, we have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
We have a second. Further discussion?
Thank you for your work.
Okay.
All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same.
Motion okay. carried. Thanks.
Right. Thank you. All right. Committee reports.
Slightly. Last Thursday, I attended the Clay County Children's Mental Health Local Advisory Committee, Council, rather, and met some of the stakeholders that were involved in that. They are working on a survey in the months of February and March, which will be reviewed at the April meeting. And they are going to be conducting a resource fair. That'll be coming up this spring, and this will, including information how they can host a mental health fair for the community. And that was it for the, they have a mobile mental health unit that works with solutions. And I was, of course, being a new council member or commission member, I'm learning about all these things on the job. And there's quite a bit to it, of course. And they discussed such things as the out-of-home placement, 152 children in the county in out-of-home placement, and 52 foster homes, and they're all full, and how much need we have for additional foster homes. Then yesterday in the afternoon, I attended the ACES, which is
Adverse Childhood Experience.
Thank you, Frank. Adverse Childhood Experience, and I attended the portion that was being held by Dave Elliott, and he was the presenter. And what they were doing is they were having breakout sessions with the different entities that were there. There was probably 150 people, something like that, from the various agencies around. And people that are involved in adverse childhood experiences. And that was it.
Right. Mr. Gross.
As long as he's talking about that adverse, I attended the morning session there yesterday at St. Francis Church up there. And what I got from the morning session was, I mean, we had a lot of different, we have people from North Dakota there and all the different groups. They're all involved in this stuff. And what I was hearing mostly, yeah, we know what to do. We need some funding, you know, and that's pretty much what I heard in the morning was that we've got the programs now, and now give us the money to do them. Last Tuesday, I guess, yeah, we had an EMS meeting. Clay County is having a problem getting first responders. You know, like they, I know, I think they were talking about Felth, and they're down to probably one person as far as first responders and all that. I mean, every city almost is having problems with first responders. So what Brian Green was looking at is having a Clay County first responders team. You know, it's a new idea, and we're looking at that. Is that something good to do? You know, have about 6-8 people be on this first responders team, you know. Well, it would involve a little setting them all up, you know. You'd have to have a radio, a pager, a vest, a jump bag. They'd be training. They're looking at $2,800 per person almost to train these, to get a first responders for Clay County. Because a lot of times you have a first responder probably lives in Yulin, but it works in Fargo or Hawley, whatever the case may be. The first responders aren't there. These would be people in different areas of the county that would be first responders, and looking at getting that program started. Partnership for Health on Friday morning, there we talked about Healthy Families America and Nurse Family Partnership with two different programs and getting kids, working with the children and getting them involved. They're looking at people who, some of the kids that are in, helping out with the food program, meals, you know, in the schools. They're finding out some of those kids are the ones that are having the lowest graduation rates also, you know, so they're looking at that part of the program and trying to work with that. Mary Frank gave a financial report that showed the Partnership for Health, the group is coming along very good. They're getting a lot of money from grants and stuff like that, so the group's coming along good with that. Then this morning, we went to that, everybody was at that breakfast, which I was at too. I guess I really want to thank Brian, stood up and thanked us for our work in the jail. And, you know, after you look at this opiate stuff and all the stuff that's going on in the county, you know, sometimes you think, well, what are we doing? And all of a sudden, it sort of made me realize we are doing something about it. You know, we are trying to help out the opiate addictions and stuff like that. So, yeah, we are as commissioners here. We are, and for the county, I want them to be aware of it. We are working on it, and we need to do more work, definitely, but we are working on it. And thank you, Brian, for your words on that. My report.
Thank you.
I got one more thing I'd like to say, if that's okay. Mm-hmm. I forgot to say earlier that April is Child Abuse Prevention Month, and the Minnesota Communities Caring for Children program is awarding the Pinwheel Awards to different organizations that are involved in child advocacy. Mm-hmm. So, that's going on.
All right. Commissioner Wayland.
I had no meetings last night.
Commissioner Mojo.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. I also attended the EMS meeting with Commissioner Gross, and I think when it comes down to it, the county has a obligation, whether people like it or not, to keep people safe. And if there are lack of volunteers for whatever reason that is, and if we were looking at response rates from 50 to 66% on some things, we do have a obligation to try and mitigate that somehow. And I appreciate Brian and Sergeant Emptine and the ambulance service also for trying to look at ways to help that out. I attended the Planning Commission meeting last week. There were three issues on the table. One was withdrawn because of a variance that had been denied earlier before the meeting. The second piece was the preliminary plat for the subdivision in Holly Township. They'd come before us, I believe, 3 weeks ago to remove the aggregate protection. That was sent back to be reworked a little bit because their variance was also denied at an earlier meeting. And then there was a request for an interim use permit in Elmwood Township that was approved, but there were a significant amount of concerned citizens, so I hope we were able to put different parameters within the permit to address their concerns. I attended the MetroCog Executive Committee last week. That office attended a sensitivity training from the encouragement of our board, and I think it was a very well done training put on by the Village Family Services. And those services continue to follow when you pay for the training. It follows them for like a year or two. So I think that's a great thing. One update is that Horace has petitioned to join MetroCog. So the executive committee looked at how that would affect different cost structures because it's based on population. That would not affect Clay County's allotment. It would affect Cass County's because it would come out of what their fee schedule is. That's something that the board will talk about further. I attended the Joint Powers meeting last Thursday. We had an update from Lori Winterfield on the finances from the intergovernmental retreat. I appreciated that. I was kind of in the dark on how that all works, so I appreciate that she was able to clarify, and we had a good discussion on comments from the retreat. I think overall people felt it was a worthwhile retreat, which is always important to us, and we talked about future meeting topics and talking a little bit more about the opioid addiction issues. And yesterday I attended the law library. Thanks, Jenny, for making sure everything's in tip-top shape there. Their balances look great. If you recall, last fall we cut a significant amount of the print subscriptions, which was a huge dollar savings. We're talking a little bit about what we want to offer with that savings. And if you've not had a chance to look at the new law library, make sure and go downstairs. It's a very nice space. One piece that I talked to Commissioner Wayland a little bit about is in planning and design for the new correctional facility. One point was to make sure that the terminal for the Westlaw materials is in a appropriate space. Talk to Jenny further about that, but I think that's been problematic with the current jail, so as you're in those meetings, think about that. That concludes my report.
All right, thank you.
And I attended this morning, I guess.
Yeah, I also attended the Planning Commission last week, and Commissioner Mojo gave a good detail of that report, of that meeting. Then on Wednesday, I attended the Red River Basin Commission retreat and board meeting that was held in Grand Forks. And again, it went over what their goals and objectives are and their concerns. And ultimately, amongst everyone, flood protection is still key. It's the top item that they want to see, the importance of permanent flood protection. The next on the list was the availability of water and the quality of water, how important those things are. And so, it's on the same track. We're, I mentioned that, on our side of the river here in Clay County, the issues that we have with our wellhead protection areas and how we make sure that we're going to protect our groundwater sources is important in case some other areas don't have that, they should be considering it. But, and then the Joint Powers, Clay County Joint Powers meeting was Thursday, and I concur that, we had a good recap on the retreat. And then we discussed the opioid issue more and some other items. But as Commissioner Gross mentioned, that we're involved with a lot of these issues in terms of what we're trying to do. And as Mr. Berg said this morning at the banquet, that we're involved with the correctional facility and what we're doing. But I think everybody needs to know that we have members of our county staff who are part of this Blue Ribbon Commission that are working really hard, the right people from different departments. Those of us that sit around this table, we make decisions based on their reports on how we can improve things. But the ones who are really on the street and doing the fight to figure out what's going on and then how we can step in and help solve, I think we've got a good force there too that's part of that commission, and I'm glad we have members of our county staff doing that. As you know, as we all heard this morning, how critical that opioid issue is. So that was at breakfast, and that's all I have as well. Brian.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair. I guess first off, I was on vacation last week, so my first responsibility is to thank you for that opportunity to go on vacation. I appreciate that. I really do.
And thanks for the long well.
Please take more. Well, that was good. That was good. But I'm going to touch on just a couple that are old news to you. The PIC meeting, I know that was reported on and reviewed the minutes from last week, so I won't talk about that. The diversion project, there was a board meeting the week before, and I did attend that. But there was also a project review. You've heard about the fact that there are four engaged in preparing proposals for the channel that goes around, and they're having questions on a weekly basis now, so they're calling us over to review those questions because they want a response that's from the staff of all of the entities that are represented there. So they're bringing us together on a weekly basis for that now too. Did meet with Kirk and Larry from the landfill on the charges at the landfill. We've been asked to do a little work on that to see what if everything is in line. And then I attended the solid waste meeting for just a short time and listened to the presentation and the video that you showed at the last board meeting. Darren and I met with the labor attorney to update all of the issues that were going on with the labor, the contracts, and some other things. And, met with Commissioner Gross and Mojo, referenced the behavioral health space and the visitation rooms and things, and I thought we had a good meeting to clarify some points in regards to that issue. You've already met, you've had a meeting since this, but I attended the rural cities, rural county city meeting, and I thought that went really well, and I know there was some enthusiasm for holding another one, and in fact, I think the mayor from Glendon offered to host it in approximately 6 months, so and you all were in attendance at that, so. Tim Dent and I met with MVM, the contracting group that does some power, underground power that hooked the line, that popped the water line and things, so we got that all kind of straightened out on the damage and the bill and things along those lines. Just, I guess, a advisement here. I think you all got your invitation, but the township officers are meeting March 20th in Dilworth this time. They have met in Glendon, but they're meeting in Dilworth. So you want to make that notification. Had Lori's evaluation yesterday, so doing personnel evaluations on an ongoing basis. The retreat for the department heads and the commissioners on April 4th will be at the CCRI building, the same place that we had the Joint Powers retreat in January. That building, they do not charge us for room there, and then we'll have lunch brought in. So we were planning on it for the highway department, and Darren has been working on this for me, and I suggested that we contact those people. That's a very nice meeting room, so we'll meet there. And Lori and Mike just about have the process ready for the sending out the information on the bills on Monday before your Tuesday meeting, and that'll be coming out. We'll probably launch that then very soon, but they needed a little more time to refine some billing of it. Just a reminder that not all of the vouchers will be available on Monday evening to review because of the social service vouchers that come in at a late date, and that's a tough schedule to change for them, but they will be certainly available Tuesday morning. Yes, I attended that opioid presentation this morning as well. I thank you for that opportunity. And I'm going to reiterate just a little more, and that's for the people that are watching this, probably that are Clay County residents, of how much the county commissioners are involved in this. And you mentioned it, Chair Campbell, that the staff does work on a lot of things. And then they bring those ideas for support to you. And if you remember right, you added a deputy here about, a year and a half ago for the street crimes unit. You've added positions through the state granting process in public health for educational purposes. You've added 7 child protection social workers. You have supported all of these functions. And don't kid yourself, this opioid and drug abuse is adding to your out-of-home costs for your children. And you folks are supporting that. And that brings me to the issue of our employees. And the one presenter this said this morning that your employee assistance program is one of the most valuable things that you can have for your employees. And Darren reported last week, and in reviewing the minutes, he said that we have over 500 employees. Well, probably about 4 1/4 are full-time employees, somewhere right in that area. And then we have a lot of part-time employees as well. But the department heads hear from me on a regular basis that with that kind of volume that we have employed, don't think for a minute that we don't have somebody out there that's using. Who they are, I don't know. Which department they're in, I don't know. If we knew, we would help them. But they do surface from time to time because we have all, the three of us here, Jenny and Darren and myself, have all dealt with these situations over the recent years, and we do what we can, get them the help, and frankly, if that doesn't work out, then we have to part company. But it's very important that you have an active employee assistance program, and you folks support that. So there's just another example that you are supporting this function, but there was 3 elements that they mentioned this morning, that you need to train your employees. And that starts with the orientation that you go through and what's available to them from benefits. You need to train your supervisors to recognize signs and things. We are conducting an annual supervisory training, and we need to incorporate that probably into that supervisor training more. And the third thing was dedication from the top down, and I'm just going to accent, we have that from our commissioners. You do support, not blindly, you ask good questions, but you support the programs this county is trying to implement on their help. And we really, as county employees, really appreciate that. And Mr. Chair, that concludes my report.
Brian, based on that meeting this morning, I have a couple of questions that I wanted to direct to our HR department. And so I'm wondering if maybe, Darren, if we could put on for our next PIC meeting the employee assistance program, just as an item for topic. I have a couple of questions this isn't the time or the place to do it, but I want to just get a little background information first, so thank you. Jenny, anything?
No, lots of legal going on, but nothing to report.
All right, you're good, all right. Anything else? All right, we're adjourned, thank you.